What do we find at the intersection of faith and the world? Our new podcast, Crossroads, explores this question in thought-provoking conversations featuring guests from around the world who are seeking to live faithfully in the public square. This is a safe space to discuss politics, technology, and our responsibilities as citizens. Pull up a chair and meet us as we search for a better way forward. Welcome to Crossroads, where we discuss the intersection of sacred and civic. I'm your host, Joe Nygaard-Owens. Today, we'll hear a conversation between Dean Randy and conductor Marin Alsop, music director and conductor of the National Orchestral Institute and Festival Philharmonic. Marin is one of the foremost conductors of our time, and she is the first woman to serve as the head of a major orchestra in the United States, South America, Austria, and Britain. Marin was kind enough to give us a few minutes of her time when she was at the Cathedral to conduct Beethoven's iconic Ninth Symphony, the most popular symphony of all time. This was the first symphony ever written with text and a choir, and the message of the symphony is one of unity, tolerance, and ultimately about joy. A key memory for Marin is watching her teacher, Leonard Bernstein, conduct musicians from all over the world at the Berlin Wall as it was coming down. At this event, Bernstein actually changed the text for this momentous occasion. Instead of the word joy, he switched it to freedom. That example of adjusting the text to suit the context of its performance inspired Marin in her own work. Marin was a featured artist in Carnegie Hall's celebration of the 250th anniversary of Beethoven's birth, for which Carnegie commissioned former United States Poet Laureate Tracy K. Smith to reimagine Schiller's poem as a contemporary meditation on community, politics, and spirit. Her words invoke those same feelings of unity, harmony, community, and joy. In the show notes, we have a link to Tracy reading her poem. We hope you enjoy this conversation between Dean Randy and Marin Alsop.
So, Marin, you're one of the foremost conductors of our time. I want to read some of your accomplishments here, if you wouldn't mind. The first woman to serve as the head of a major orchestra in the United States, in South America, and Austria, and Britain. This is your fifth season as chief conductor of the Vienna Radio Symphony Orchestra, and your first season as artistic director and chief conductor of the Polish National Radio Symphony, and as principal guest conductor of London's Philharmonia Orchestra. You're also chief conductor of the Ravinia Festival. How do you do all of those at the same time?
Oh, you left a couple out.
No, I think there's some more, aren't there?
No, I'm just, I just was recently appointed principal guest of the Philadelphia Orchestra.
Oh, yes.
So that's in the neighborhood, thank heavens. I don't have to get on a plane to go to see them. You know, it's... You have to be careful what you wish for in life, you know? Sometimes success brings lots of stress along with it, but I'm very privileged and grateful to have so many different opportunities throughout the world, and not just here in the United States, but to be able to experience the culture in Austria and be in Vienna for these past 5 years. I have one more year on my contract there, and I've loved every second of it. And now to be in Poland is a completely different cultural experience, you know, but what I find is that everywhere I go, music is indeed a universal language, and it really does bring us closer together always.
Well, as we'd say in the church, you're obviously a blessing to many.
Well, thank you.
And you're here today with us at the Cathedral for a concert this evening of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony with the National Orchestral Institute and Festival.
Yeah, this is an orchestra comprised of pre-professional musicians. I think the average age is probably about 24 years old, and they're selected from auditions throughout the United States, and they come together for 5-6 weeks every summer, and they play, and they get to know each other, and it's very exciting because I'm also bringing them to the Ravinia Festival in 2 weeks. So that's another, not only is it a special season because of our appearance here at the Cathedral with Beethoven 9, but we're also playing Mahler 1 at Ravinia. So it's great.
Wow, those are some wonderful pieces, but they're challenging, aren't they?
They are. They really stretch the kids. And it's wonderful to work with young people because they have almost an innocence and an enthusiasm that sometimes more experienced musicians find hard to show. These kids love to show it, and I enjoy working with them a lot.
Tell us a little bit what it's like being here at the Cathedral. Have you conducted here at the Cathedral before?
This is my first time in the Cathedral, and definitely my first time conducting here as well. And I have to say that the acoustics, I was expecting them to be more challenging than they are. I mean, of course, they're extremely resonant, as one would expect, but it's surprisingly manageable, I think. And the choir sounds magnificent in here. So I think for me, it was a pleasant surprise.
Oh, that's wonderful. I wish it was so good for the spoken voice.
Yeah, I imagine that because of the delay challenge.
Well, talk to me a little bit about conducting Beethoven's Ninth. It's such a famous piece. What is that like?
I think that experience of the first time one conducts this piece and approaches this piece is pretty daunting, thinking that how many other great conductors have conducted this piece, you know, over the centuries. For me, it's a very personal piece. Beethoven is one of my personal heroes, and not only because of his incredible musical genius, but also the way he was connected to the world outside of him. You know, for Beethoven, it was a big challenge because he lost his hearing, started to lose his hearing at a very early age in his 20s. And all the doctors told him, you know, this is irreversible and it's only going to continue and eventually you will be deaf. And I think for Beethoven, it was, as you can imagine, for any composer who relies on his or her ears and hearing, it was really a devastating prognosis. And yet somehow Beethoven managed to find an optimism and a joy about life and about being a creative person. And he refused to take any kind of medications ever because it could dampen his artistic fervor and intuitions. And I just think that for someone, he wanted desperately to connect with people, and of course, he became more and more isolated. Beethoven's 250th anniversary year was the year of COVID, and I thought that was only fitting because he represented what we were all going through, this sense of isolation and the inability to connect. So for me, Beethoven is, he's really not just a hero from the past, but a hero from the present. And his philosophy that music can unite and bring joy and that humanity needs to stay connected and tolerance is important. And all of these messages that are conveyed in the Schiller poem, which he used as the text for his Ninth Symphony, even though the poem was written in the 1700s, Beethoven had it in mind always to use it. And during the anniversary year, during the COVID year, I commissioned 9 new texts for various different countries, and the text we're singing today is by the former U.S. Poet Laureate Tracy K. Smith. But I asked her to write a poem that really highlighted and spotlighted the same goals and the same themes and the same philosophy that Beethoven espoused. So it's poetry about respecting our planet and valuing each other. And those are the same themes that the Schiller conveyed.
You know, I was reading over Tracy K. Smith's poem, and it's quite powerful. And I love the last piece of it where she writes about joy. She writes, "Let us feel it, let us heed it, let us seek its deepest kiss. Let us live our brief lives mining that which joy alone can give." It's such really
beautiful.
Yeah,
it's beautiful. Really beautiful.
So Beethoven was literally completely deaf when he wrote the Ninth Symphony,
yes.
Wasn't he?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
It's amazing he would find joy.
That's the thing. When he first received the diagnosis as a 20-something-year-old, he really did consider ending his life. I mean, that's how devastating it was. And he wrote a very famous letter to his brothers, and then he tore it up. And he decided to choose living and to choose optimism. And I think that's a great model for all of us today, especially in the world we live in where there's so many problems and there's so much divisiveness. And if we can get back to thinking about a figure like Beethoven, who was able to somehow put that aside and put all of his personal ailments and real tragic issues aside and focus on the joy of being human.
You know, at the Cathedral, we've been working all year on an expansive program that we're calling A Better Way. We're doing it specifically during this election year, bringing in speakers, politicians, various folks to lift up the importance of civility, of tolerance, of finding a better way to live together and listen to one another, trying to promote some of the fundamental values that we think are so important. And you talk about that Beethoven's Ninth is not only, of course, about joy, but it's about unity and tolerance. Right. Say more about that.
I think it's also about possibility. The piece opens, you know, it's a entire story. I know that some people listen to the piece and they're waiting for the choir to come in, but it's a journey from the first note to when the choir comes in. Because the first interval is what we call a perfect fifth, and it doesn't matter. You don't have to be a musician to know this, but it's an interval that is empty. So it's not major, it's not minor. It's an interval that is filled with possibility. And I think that's what this first movement is about. It's about exploring possibility. And that possibility then comes to fruition, finally, when the choir joins. You know, this is the very first symphony ever written that had a chorus in it. And Beethoven was, I think he was roundly criticized, like, what a bad idea, adding that choir. But as it turns out, not such a bad idea at all. Yeah. But Beethoven was active always politically. And he always stood up for what he believed in. What's interesting, he has a history, of course, in his life of writing music to pay tribute to different figures of the time. He originally wrote his third symphony called the Eroica Symphony and dedicated it to Napoleon until he found out that Napoleon was a megalomaniac and he tore up the dedication page and just left the title Eroica. So he was very much a citizen of the world. And I think that art can really connect us to each other in that way. The great thing is that it's nonpartisan. You can hear a piece of music and two people can hear the same piece of music and have vastly different reactions, and they're all valid.
Absolutely. And as we think as well that music and art are also such wonderful expressions of the holy, or at least can be in people's lives.
For me, Beethoven really comes the closest to, I think, that spiritual nirvana moment in some of his music, some of his late string quartets. They're transcendental to me. And I think everyone would agree if I sat you down in a quiet room and played the cavatina from his late string quartet, I think everyone would say, oh, yes, that is next to God for sure. Mm.
So we like to ask all of our guests who come on the podcast, as we think about the state of our world, the state of our country, as we've been talking a little bit about, where do you find your hope? What do you find most hopeful?
I think that, you know, for me, of course, music is a refuge. It gives me hope. I mean, working with these young musicians, I see the future through them. I think that when I have an experience of conducting a concert where the audience is really engaged, and they're engaged not just with us on stage, but with each other, that gives me hope, because I then see the power of community. And maybe for me, music is analogous to community. So that's what gives me hope.
Beautifully said. Thank you. Thank you very much. Music is so important to all of us here at the Cathedral, not only for the beauty that it creates, but also for the sense of holiness that it offers as well. We think that music is a centerpiece of our ministry for the city of Washington and for the nation. One of my favorite quotes was by C.S. Lewis. He said, One of the great goals of my life has been to find the place where all the beauty came from, which I think is just a marvelous expression. And I want to thank you for all the beauty that you bring into the world for so many. It's a real gift to have you here.
Thank you. It's wonderful to be here.
We're grateful to Marin Alsop for joining Dean Randy for this conversation, and thank you all so much for listening. The concert was a unique, in-person-only experience, but we look forward to having Marin with us again in the future. To learn more about the Cathedral's A Better Way program that Dean Randy described, go to cathedral.org/abetterway. On our next episode, I talk with Rebecca Roberts, author of Untold Power, The Fascinating Rise and Complex Legacy of First Lady Edith Wilson. Both President Wilson and First Lady Wilson are buried at the Cathedral, and I sat down with Rebecca and Kevin Ekstrom, our Chief Public Affairs Officer, to talk about her life and intersection with the Cathedral. Thank you for listening to Crossroads, and until next time, peace be with you. If the digital offerings of the Cathedral enrich your daily life, please consider becoming a supporter today by making a gift at cathedral.org/inspire.